Assalamu alaikum and a very good day, to Dr. Kamaruddin and all. My name is Nur Hazmah binti Zahid and I'm from TSLB2. For this course, which is Philosophy and Education in Malaysia, I will be presenting on the topic International Performance Standard. So to start off, we're going to look at the table of content. So we're going to look at three things, which is first one, International Performance Standard, second, PISA and TIMSS, and last one would be the implication to its curriculum. So what is International Performance Standard? So International Performance Standard can be defined as a measure that can assess the level of effectiveness of the curriculum and teaching method in a country, in addition to being able to compare different levels of student achievement around the world. This definition is stated by Tom Lovelace in 2008. So there are two international assessments that our country, Malaysia, took part in. The first one is PISA, which stands for Program of International Standard Achievement. The second one is TIMSS, which stands for Trends in International Mathematics and Science Study. So moving on to the second part of this topic, which is PISA and TIMSS. So what is the actual purpose of this international assessment? So PISA actually is made to measure 15 years old ability to use their reading, mathematics and science knowledge. Meanwhile, TIMSS, the purpose is to provide important background information that can be used to improve teaching and learning in mathematics and science. So let's look at PISA background. So PISA is organized by Organization for Economic Cooperation and Development, or known as OECD. PISA starts in 2000 and done every 3 years. So Malaysia had joined PISA since 2009 until now. PISA also targets at students between the age of 15 years and 3 months and 16 years and 2 months. So next is TIMSS. So TIMSS is not organized by OECD like PISA. It is organized by International Association for the Evaluation of Educational Achievement, or IEA. Unlike PISA, TIMSS is done every 4 years. And Malaysia participate in it since 1999. So TIMSS target are year 4 and form 2 students. However, in Malaysia, only the form 2 students will be participating in it. So let's look at the PISA ranking comparison throughout the years our country have been participating in. So in 2012, actually in all three categories, which are math, science and reading, our country, we did not able to achieve the average level. We fall a little bit short from the average score. As you can see on the slide, we score 404 for math, 422 for science, and 414 for reading. However, in 2018, we actually improved significantly in all three PISA literacies. Compared to 2012, we are able to get 440 for math. For science, we scored 438, and for reading, we scored 415. Actually, we moved from the bottom 30% to the middle 30% of the ranking. So next would be the factor influencing Malaysia's position in PISA. There are four factors which we are going to look at. First one, changing in education system. Second one, weaknesses in our education system. Third one, quality of teachers and teachers' workload. So, education system. So, starting from 2003, our education system is teaching science and mathematics in English, or in Malay, it is called Pengajaran dan Pembelajaran Sains dan Matematik dalam Bahasa Inggeris, PPSMI. Then in 2009, the system changed from PPSMI to MPMMBI, which stands for Memertabat Kan Bahasa Melayu Memperkukuh Bahasa Inggeris. which is the English one, uphold Bahasa Melayu, strengthen the English language. And then in 2011, it changed again to school-based assessment, which is the PBS. And the latest education system in Malaysia right now is the Education Blueprint, PPBM. So this was developed for a sustainable transformation of the education system. So actually, from 2003 to 2011, our education system changes a lot. And this actually giving the teachers and students hard times to keep track with. So this can affect our position in PISA. However, the Malaysia Education Blueprint is aimed for from 2013 until 2020, so the teachers and the students are able to actually understand and make improvement with the time given. So moving on to the next factor, which is the weaknesses in our education system. So education system is only focused on examinations and academic achievement, where this method making learning not integrated with the outside world, said Wang in 2000. And Daliani Matsais, in 2011, she stated that the students seem to be trained like machines and the learning process in school is only focused on book as the second reference material after the teacher. So the next one is the quality of teachers. So Tang and Lim in 2000, they argue that the learning process become more effective if there is an improvement in the quality of teachers. In this is because an effective teacher is the one who can produce more students who excel in both examinations and curriculum. Hence, in order to produce more excellent students, one of the keys to improve the educational development is by improving the quality of teachers. This shows that the quality of teachers and the PDP is an important element for education that needs to be emphasized. So the last one would be the workload teachers have. As we knew, being a teacher is not an easy job. Not only teachers need to teach their students, but teachers also need to do a lot of paperwork. In 1995, Fisher stated that a person who is burdened by a lot of work is not able to work effectively. And this statement is supported by Greenglass in 1997, whom stated that workload is one of the major contributions to stress among teachers. When teachers are under pressure, they are not able to give the best to their students due to their big responsibilities and plenty of work that needs to be done. So we are at the last part of this presentation, which is the implication towards curriculum. So the Ministry of Education implemented new school curriculum, which is KSSR, and revised started in 2016, while the secondary school standard curriculum, KSSM, in 2011. In effort to jumpstart the state of educational system. There's also changes in assessment towards the six-year student as they are no longer being assessed by their primary school result alone. So there are four implications. First one would be teaching methods and classroom learning will change. Second, students have their own level of development. Third, changes in terms of curriculum materials. And the last one would be higher infrastructure demand. So students have their own level of development. Students who have high intellectual that meet with the KSSR standard need to be trained by special teachers. So due to that, they are no longer exposed to old lesson. They need new one. They need to expose to the world of art and information technology. So because of students who have their own level of development, it affects changes in teaching methods and classroom learning. So the government sets conditions for teachers to provide learning modules in school. Teachers need to meet assessments so that students do not drop out the subject. And teachers also need to expand their teaching method. Actually, teachers cannot stick to one method. They need to have different method because not every students can learn with same method, and it would not be interesting for the students to be learning with the same method over and over again. So students are also encouraged to voice out their ideas during the learning process. So the learning process would be not only one way, not only the teacher will be talking, the students also can voice out their ideas, their opinions, their thoughts on the topic that they are discussing. So the next implication, change in terms of school curriculum material. So standards document for all subjects provided are set by the ministry. Teachers need to prepare lesson plans daily in accordance with the prescribed time allocation by the government. So actually, when there are changes in teaching methods and classroom learning, there will also be changes in the in terms of curriculum material, and teachers need to be well aware of that so that they do not fall behind. So the curriculum material that they'll be teaching is always the latest one. So the last one will be higher infrastructure demand. So number of infrastructure will begin to increase in school as some new subjects and improvised subjects improve the infrastructure. Because new subjects, they can be different from the normal subjects. So some subjects need tools. For instance, science and technology, the subjects require computer labs. So there will be need to improve the infrastructure. And art class need adequate infrastructure. Like, there's a lot of tools for art class. So yeah, starting from now, from now and in the future, there will be high infrastructure demand for in the school. So there's a hot question that you can wonder and think. As a future teacher, how can you contribute in order to escalate our country ranking for PISA and TIMSS? And these are my references that are used for this presentation. All the information from this slide. So these are the references. So that's all from me. Thank you to Dr. Kamaruddin and all for listening.